गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, सो वेलकम बैक टू अवर ऑनलाइन सेशन ऑफ ऑप्टिकल कम्युनिकेशन क्लास। इन टुडे सेशन वी आर मोर कंसर्न विद द कॉन्सेप्ट्स रिलेटेड टू डेरिवेशन ऑफ ग्रुप एंड द ग्रुप डिलेज एंड ग्रुप वेलोसिटीज। सो इन दैट व्हाट एक्चुअली वी आर गोइंग टू सी अबाउट हाउ द ग्रुप वेलोसिटी एंड ग्रुप डिलेज इज बीइंग यूज्ड, वेयर एक्चुअली इट इज विल बी यूजफुल फॉर अस, एंड हाउ द ऑप्टिकल कम्युनिकेशन कैन बी यूज्ड फॉर दैट पर्टिकुलर फिनोमेना। All these parameters we are going to learn in today's session. So these things we are going to learn in today's session, all the details of that, and then we are going to proceed with the functionality, working of it, the meaning of that, how it is going to work and everything. We are going to proceed with that. So this concepts actually is there for us when we just talk about the kind of delays and the kind of information, capacity information of our optical fiber. So these all the concepts we already covered in our previous sessions. So now let us move ahead with this today's sessions. We are going to see how it is going to be useful for us. So let us move ahead with that concept, students. So now, students, we are going to learn about how to characterize the dispersion. What are the things that dispersion going to be used? So basically, students, in the previous sessions we have discussed about this concept, right? So we got TG is equals to the delay, group delay is equals to L by VG, the group velocities. Right, so this already we covered in previous session. In today's session, we are more concerned with our dispersion. So basically, dispersion means what, students? Dispersion is a phenomena where you are going to utilize the group concept, and we want to find out the working of it, how the dispersion is going to occur in the optical communication. So group delay per unit length can be defined as dg by l is equals to, if you take the beta factor, if you want to differentiate d beta by d omega, we have to utilize by considering this phenomena. So by doing that, we can write 1 by c d beta by dk. By applying that omega value, omega is what actually? Omega, if you want to substitute that one, we can substitute like this. So c dk, d beta is as it is, we put it. What is c actually? Lambda square by 2 pi c. So dv by dk, we are moving into the terms of wavelength. Wavelength is lambda, right? So this is what relation between your characterized dispersion. If the spectral width of that particular optical source is not too wide, means when the what we have seen, right, the what length of that particular width of that pulses needs to be broader so that we can get the information in a particular direction, right? So in order to get that, if the spectral width of the optical source, we want to see that it's not so wide, it's not getting expanded, then the delay difference per unit wavelength, also the propagation path, is approximately d TG. TG is nothing but group delay by d lambda. So when there is no that much of wideness in their particular pulse width, that's time we can apply this particular formula. So for the spectral components, which are d lambda, delta lambda apart, subsymmetrical around center wavelength, the total group delay is difference, delta of tau over a length of L. If you want to find out that relation, we can write as delta of tau is equals to d dTg by d lambda. So if you want to multiply with delta lambda, what I can write for this, what is this expression is all about, we can substitute this condition, right? So this lambda square by 2 pi c, so this is one L, we are multiplying with this L, cross multiply L over there, L by 2 pi c, this is the d beta by d lambda, we are, this is the first derivative, this is the second time, right? This is first time, second time, if I want to do it, I can write in this form, right? So what is this dt by d omega, differentiation of your delays with respect to omega. So that if I want to write delta of omega, I can write d by d omega as it is. What is delta of omega value? If you want to substitute this t value, what is t actually? L by vg, right? By taking the relation. From this relation we can consider, right? Tg is nothing but L by vg. So that same point we are writing here in this particular formula. So t is nothing but L by vg of delta of omega. So delta of omega as it is. So L as it is. What is this found right for second time? D square beta by d omega square into delta of omega. So what is beta to actually, students? It is a, what is that actually? It is called group velocity diameter parameter. So that for dispersion it is going to use. So that is what? Group velocity dispersion parameter, GVD. As shown, how much a light pulse broadens as it travels along an optical fiber, the more common parameters is called the dispersion. When the light is getting dispersed, that light is getting scattered and the light is getting move ahead, then that time whatever the delays difference we are getting per unit length, per unit wavelength, we need to follow this particular formula to achieve that. So d is equals to 1 by l d by d lambda of tg by lambda, right? So d by d lambda as it is, students, if you want to multiply tg value, what is that? L by vg, right? LL gets cancelled, so we can write here already L is there. What is tg? L by vg. This L and this L gets cancelled, so we can write d by d lambda of 1 by vg, right? This is nothing but equals to minus 2 pi c by lambda square. Where we are getting this factor? We are getting this factor from this relation, from the main relation. This is our main relation. From here we are obtaining all this kind of characteristics part. Clear? So tg by L is nothing but minus lambda square 2 pi c d beta by d lambda. That's the relation for getting this dispersion in the group delay per unit length. For that particular phenomena, we are applying this formula. So we need to use it and we need to obtain the group delays. Whatever the group delay dispersion parameters are there, we can obtain by applying this relation. Clear? So now in case the optical pulses, suppose in the case of optical pulses, if the spectral width of the optical source is characterized by its RMS values of Gaussian pulses. So you get this also Gaussian pulses in your, what we call, in your sigma values. If you want to write your Gaussian pulses range, we can write a sigma of lambda, the pulse spreading over the length of L, the sigma g can be written as sigma g is approximately equals to d by d lambda of tg, right? So that we can write, in short, this whole differentiation parameter I'm writing as dl into sigma of lambda. So what is capital D over here? It has the typical value of your whatever the values we are putting into nanometer into kilometer. So whatever the values we want to see that factor, so we want to see that particular factor with respect to the time, the per second per nanometer kilometer. So nm into kilometer, we need to see that is the internal part of that capital D. So we can obtain in this form. So now next we need to proceed with intral model dispersion, students. So basically, what is that intral model dispersion? Till now what we have discussed, how the dispersion can be characterized for our wavelength when we consider the relation of group velocity with group delay, right? We have seen the group Tg is equal to L by Vg. So by applying that parameter, we obtain that characterization of dispersion. Next, we want to see intramodal dispersion. So basically, what is intra? We have seen two kind of dispersion, right? One is the intramodal, another is the intermodal. Intramodal is that occurring within a single mode of light. Inside the one particular light itself, if something is happening to that particular light, it is due to the group velocity, which is the function of wavelength. So whatever the values we want to pass to our intramodal dispersions, because it's happening within a single mode of light. When the light is single mode, when the light is not moving ahead, it is taking, because of the group velocity, when it is changing the function of its wavelength, the length of the wave is changing because the light is getting dispersed inside one particular single mode only, not the multimode. If it is occurring for the single mode, then it is considered to be the intramodal dispersion. Now coming back to the intermodal dispersion, basically what is into that particular form? That is because of the multimode, right? So now we want to see how this is going to be occurred. So how it is going to work on that. So in order to see that particular part, we need to see the intermodal dispersion, that is depends on the wavelength. So whatever the wavelength we do have, students, depends on that. It affects on single distortion. Whatever the single distortion is there, it is going to increase this with this spectral width. Whatever the spectral line width we do have, based upon that, if you want to see with the optical source, it is normally characterized by using the RMS spectral wavelength. So that is called as width. So characterized by the RMS spectral width. RMS is nothing but root mean square value. Always we'll try to take this RMS value only while we'll finding the particular relation of that. So as you can see here, the LEDs has, because we have learned about LEDs and our optical fiber, when we discuss about the modes, single mode and multimode, we discuss about the LEDs also, right? The LEDs have an RMS spectral width of about 5% of the central wavelength. So whatever the central wavelength we can see in the LEDs, it taking only 5% of that central wavelength. Whatever the wavelength it is there, it is taking out of the 100%, it is consuming only 5% of the central wavelength. Whereas in laser, if you see the laser part, laser diodes has much narrow spectral width of 1 to 2 nanometer. So this is much, part of that we are understanding. We are understanding that the laser diodes have much narrow spectral width of 1 to 2 nanometers. So it is occurring in the 1 and 2 nanometers scale. So because of that, the LEDs have an RMS spectral width of about 5%. Whatever the spectral width we want to see, it is taking the 5% of central wavelength. Whereas laser diodes has narrow spectral widths. it is only taking very less spectral width is there. It is about 1 to 2 nanometers. Clear? So this is all about your intramodal. So intramodal dispersion. Now coming back to the main causes of why the intramodal is occurring, because of two reasons. One is material and wave guides. Based upon the material and wave guides, this intramodal is going to occur. That is important. You need to understand that how the intramodal is going to occur. So we have learned about two things, right? Intermodal, intramodal. If it is intramodal, students, it is all about a single light source. When we see the single light source, when the only the single mode we are considering, inside that only it is going to occur, then that kind of dispersion is considered to be the intramodal. So that's occurring because of material. What kind of material we are using? Is it chromatic or non-chromatic? As we are using material or chromatic dispersion, so because of that, it is going to occur. So now let us move ahead with that concept, the main causes of intramodal dispersion. As you can see here, the material or chromatic dispersion is what in whatever the we are using single mode fiber, SMF is nothing but student, it is a single mode fiber because we are considering only single mode, right, for to get the intramodal. So in the single mode fiber, due to the diffraction property, so which property we are considering? Diffraction, that is a property of our optical fiber. So deviating from this position, it is getting diffracted. Right, so this is because the spread of narrow pulses in the constant refractive index of core material. So always, whenever our pulse is getting narrow, whenever we are giving a pulse, a person like we are giving the exact pulse, but the pulse after passing to this single mode fiber, it is getting narrow because of what is the constant value? Because of the constant refractive index of the core, because we are passing our light in the core only, right? So that is called as intramodal dispersion. So you can write definition as also this way also you can write it down for intramodal dispersion. So this dispersion arises due to the variation of refractive index of the core material. So whatever the core material we want to see, you want to see the function of that, how it is going to occur. So the dispersion whatever arises due to the variation of the refractive index of the core material as a function of optical wavelength. So when we see the optical wavelength, when you want to find out their wavelength of the value of it, when you want to see that one, based on the wavelength, if the variation is occurring of the core, then the dispersion arises. If that deviation not happening, then that dispersion is not going to arise. Why it is occurring? Because we are using a different material to get the core, right? So that's the reason this dispersion arises due to the variation of refractive index of the core material as a function of optical wavelength. So what is the main concept in this? We just want to see how the wavelength is going to occur. And what are the parameters that wavelength is going to depend on? So based upon that, if you want to see the occurrence of your dispersion, then that is because of that dispersion phenomena only. The core material is getting moving in that particular part and is getting this way. So that causes a wavelength dependence of the group velocities of any given mode. So whatever the given modes we are going to see, students, so based upon that, it is going to occur. That is, what is the meaning of that? So wavelength dependence of the group velocity of any given mode means whenever we want to see pulse spreading occurs, even when different optical wavelengths follow the same optical path. If the wavelengths are different but following the same optical path, in that kind of scenario, this dispersion arises because of wavelength dependence. Whatever group velocity we see, students, all are depend upon our wavelength only, right? What is the length of the wave? That is the lambda value. Based on that value of lambda only, the wave is going to proceed with dispersion. So because of that also it is going to occur. So next, how it is occurring, whatever the theoretical part I said you, how it is going to occur. See here, if I want to see an emitter, as you can see in my material what I had an emitter, right? It's emitting the light over there. So material dispersion is occurring. How it is occurring? What is the reason for that? Because we are passing very short light pulse, only very short light pulse we are passing to that. And as I pass with the group velocity, lambda 1, lambda 2, what is the group velocity? Taking a different wavelength, right? So it's taking lambda 1, lambda 2. Where it is getting passed? It is passed in the core. Then output is getting produced. So as you can see in the waveform, this is my lambda 1, lambda 2. This is my lambda naught. This is my spectrum of intensity with respect to wavelength. If you want to see that one, how I will get? If I pass inside, this will be the inside part, intensity. But at the output, if you want to see how it is occurring, see, it is getting broader, right? So this is actually become narrow inside, then after reaching to this become broader, but the kind of amplitude is decreases, right? Here we consider the lambda, here we consider the delay, right? So this is actually the material dispersion diagram. So you should have to draw that. You need to understand how it is occurring. This is input end. This is the inside the part. It is getting the output at the core end, right? So because of that, all kind of thing, it is going to occur. So what are the things we have learned in that? So whatever the excitation sources are inherently non-monochromatic. It is not necessary that it should be a single, it's chromatic light. It can be non-chromatic, means passing a multiple lights at all the direction and emits within a spectral value. If you want to see that, it is occurring because of the spectrum of lambda square of wavelengths, different wavelengths we are considering. Wave is actually, what actually wave? In that word, what we are seeing? So in wave in the guide with different free space wavelength travel at different group velocities. When the wavelengths are different, when the we are passing with the free space, when the wavelengths are different because of the group velocity due to the wave dependence, wavelength dependence of N1. If you had N1 value of the refractive index, that particular wave arises at the end of the fiber. Because of that, it is getting arising at the end of the fiber at different times, and hence they are getting broadened. So that's the output of the broadness, right? So what I just now said, I said that this is my excitation source, this is my input source. When I pass through this non-chromatic part of it, it is getting emitted by the spectrum. So it gets emitted over there, and the wave, whatever the wave we are seeing, it's using different space, right? Because of that, different wavelength. As you can see, lambda 1, lambda 2, no? These are what? Different wavelengths. So it is there inside the core. So when I take a group velocity, that Vg, what actually I'm assuming in this, I can see over here, it is getting different free space wavelength travel at a different group velocity due to the whatever the wave is there. It depends upon what parameter, student, depends upon refractive index as well as depends upon wavelength, right? These two important parameters is there for our wave. So whenever we pass that particular wave to our waveguide, we can observe that it is getting broadened. It is getting broadened, we can say, or it is getting somewhat more time period is getting increased for that. So that kind of thing of that wavelength N1, if you want to see, the wave arrives at the end of the fiber at different times, and hence they can represent broadening output pulses as shown in the figure. So in the figure itself, you can able to see how this gonna occur and how it is going to work for that particular phenomena. We are also see in the from the waveform as well as from the derivation and from the block. Right, as you can see over the block of that material dispersion, this is how it's gonna occur. Clear? So make a note of it. So then we can proceed with the next part. What is the next part, student? The derivation part. How it is occurring? So after knowing the diagram, what we assume in the diagram, we say that whenever we're passing any light, when it passes to the fiber, inside the fiber we do have a core. In the core, we are taking different wavelength with the different group velocities. When it is passing at the output, we can say that the pulse is getting broadened because our dispersion depends upon, or a wave depends upon, wavelength as well as the refractive index. So because of these two kind of parameters, our wave is going to depend. So the next concept what we do have is material dispersion, students. So basically, what is the material dispersion? Whatever the refractive index of material we do have, that varies as a function of wavelength. So whatever the values we are considering, students, that varies with respect to this wavelength, right? So wavelength is nothing but n of lambda. So what we said that the refractive index of any material of dispersion, if you want to see, that always is a function of wavelength, that is represented by n of lambda. So as you can see, the n of lambda, if you want to see, the material induced dispersion for a plane wave. So for the plane wave, if you want to see the wave propagation in homogeneous medium of refractive index n, that can be given by this formula. So T, whatever this we are seeing for the material is what? Mat. T mat is equals to L d beta by d omega, right? What is d beta by d omega, students? We found the relation, right? For the characterization of dispersion, we have seen d beta by d omega of L can be written as L as it is, d beta by d omega in terms of lambda, if you want to substitute the lambda value, it can be written as minus lambda square by 2 pi c d beta by d lambda. L as it is, this omega we are writing in terms of lambda. After that, what we did? We put this as it is, L as it is, what is beta value? 2 pi into n of lambda. This already lambda is there, that we are keeping as it is. So beta is nothing but 2 pi by lambda, no? Relation of beta and wavelength. So beta is 2 pi by lambda into n of lambda. So if you want to write the common factor in this, what I can write, if you further classify, if you take a derivative of those kind of thing, we can write, in short, L by C. What is this C? This is C, right? L by C, 2 pi, 2 pi, get cancelled. We left with here, d by d lambda, right? So d are multiplying with this n, so I can write dn by d lambda with this lambda. Where is this gone? This is will be move inside part. So this as it is become lambda, and this lambda and this one lambda gets cancelled. So if we multiply with lambda factor, and dn by d lambda will be left out for us, right? So now, how do we get the pulse spread? Same thing, we just want to see, right? Just now we see for the Gaussian part. Gaussian part we find the kind of sigma g. Sigma g is nothing but the spread, the pulse spread due to the material dispersion is therefore can be written as, what is that? It is given by sigma of g is approximately equals to d by differentiation of your, what? Your, we are taking for delay, right? T of material for that propagation, for that moving in the dispersion, T of mat by d lambda into sigma of lambda, right? So what is the sigma of lambda? I can write, so d, if we take second time derivative of that, so it can be written as d square by d lambda square with this factor we are multiplying inside. So L sigma of lambda, the sigma of lambda as it is, L by C we do have students, so we can write L by C as it is. We are not considering this minus parameter, only we are seeing second time derivative of this, but d square n by d lambda square. So in other way, what I can write for the